Test, test. Oh, it's working. Do you want me to start? Good morning, everyone. Happy sunny Thursday, 83 degrees. Woo! We want to get started. It's 8:35, and Robin likes to be very punctual with our event. So thank you, thank you, thank you, everyone, for coming. I think this is going to be our largest group virtually and in person in the last few years, and we're very excited. My name is Dr. Lisa Gil-Pires. I am the Senior Vice President of Medical Affairs, Chief Medical Officer, and Medical Director of the Hebrew Home of Greater Washington. I oversee the medical affairs for the entire campus at Charles E. Smith Life Communities, and I've been with our organization almost 10 years. Thank you for joining us today. This is our 13th annual Sara and Samuel Lessans Healthcare Symposium. I would like to thank and recognize Ellen and Stuart Lessans seated up here in the front, doctor and doctor. This symposium is made possible by Drs. Ellen and Stuart Lessans in loving memory of Stuart's parents, Sara and Samuel L. Lessans. I would also like to welcome our esteemed President and CEO, Bruce Lederman. Thank you for your support, Bruce. And we are honored to present this event every year to provide education and networking opportunities to our community. This year, our event is a hybrid, and I want to welcome those who are joining us virtually. Thank you. Charles E. Smith Life Communities is committed to providing quality services to older adults and their families. On any given day, we have a meaningful impact on the lives of 1,000 older adults living on our campus. At Hebrew Home of Greater Washington for post-acute care and rehabilitation, as well as long-term nursing care, at Revitz House and Ring House for independent living, and at Landau House and Cohen Rosen House for assisted living and memory care, respectively. Our commitment to quality extends beyond our campus as well. At the Hirsch Health Center, our outpatient medical practice, and also our Elder Safe Center, which coordinates communities' response to elder abuse. I am pleased to report that Hebrew Home of Greater Washington has been recognized as a best nursing home for short-term rehabilitation and long-term care for the years 2022 and 2023 by U.S. News and World Report. Only 16% of the United States skilled care facilities earned the best nursing home designation this year. Congratulations. Thank you. We are also honored by Pinnacle Quality Insights, as Cohen Rosen House, one of our memory care residences, was presented with a 2023 Customer Experience Award. Qualifying for the Pinnacle Customer Experience Award means that Cohen Rosen House placed in the top 15% of care providers nationwide across a 12-month period. Congrats, Cohen Rosen House. We are able to fulfill our mission to provide quality services because of the dedication and support of our community. I would also like to recognize and thank our corporate partners, Minkoff Company and Optum Healthcare. I'd welcome Lorraine Nemako from Optum. Thank you, Lorraine, for joining us, and thank you for your partnership today. Please join me in thanking them. Another partner I'd like to thank is Suburban Hospital, Johns Hopkins Medicine. Every year, they are a loyal supporter of this program. Thank you, Suburban Hospital. And also Health Facilities Association of America for their support in providing the continuing education credits for our social workers and our nursing home administrators. And also the Maryland Nursing Association for their support in approving continuing education for our nurses. So thank you to those supporters. Lastly, I'd like to acknowledge and thank our Symposium Planning Committee. This group begins meeting almost 1 year in advance of the symposium. Their dedication, support, and expertise are what make this event such a huge success every year. Personally, I am extremely proud of being on this committee and planning this event for all of you every year. It's always magnificent. And I could not end my thank yous without highlighting and recognizing our Symposium Planning Committee leader, Robin Lerner, who does not like to be acknowledged or recognized, but her energy is amazing and contagious. She's extremely dedicated to this event every year and magically brings it all together for us. Thank you so much, Robin. Without you, this would not be possible. So to Robin and our planning committee, please stand to be recognized. Stuart. Thank you all. It's my pleasure to introduce now our keynote speaker for this morning, Mr. Anthony Cirillo, who is a fellow of the American College of Healthcare Executives, aging an expert, and an experienced thought leader in healthcare. Mr. Cirillo is on the National Board of SeniorNet and the chair of the Lake Norman Community Health Clinic. He is the former senior care expert for verywell.com, a past executive board member for the Dementia Action Alliance, member of the Nationwide Financial National Council on Aging Health and Wellness Roundtable, and a member of the Bank of America Elder Care Policy Roundtable. Mr. Cirillo writes monthly for U.S. News and World Report and 60 and Me, and appears monthly on the Charlotte Today television program. As a fellow of the American College of Healthcare Executives, Mr. Cirillo consults with healthcare organizations globally. His article, The Chief Experience Officer, became an impetus for the Cleveland Clinic to create an Office of Patient Experience, hire the first hospital chief experience officer, and create a groundswell to promote better patient experiences. Please join me in welcoming Mr. Anthony Cirillo.
There you go. All right. So I'm going to put my timer on so we stay on Robin's schedule. I'm going to get a sip of water and pick up my clicker. So as serious as that all was, you're not going to get a very serious program out of me, as demonstrated by let's getting started. So you got your hands ready for clapping, right? All right, let's go. Where's my music, guys? There we go. Come on. You make me feel so young. You make me feel like spring is sprung. You can bring the music up a little bit. Anytime I see you grin, I'm such a happy individual. The moment that you speak, I want to go and play hide and seek. I want to go and bounce the moon just like a toy balloon. You and I are just like a couple of tots running around the meadow, picking up lots of forget-me-nots. You make me feel so young. You make me feel there are songs to be sung, bells to be rung, a wonderful fling to be flung. And even when I'm old and gray, I'm gonna feel the way I do today, because you make me feel so. You make me feel so. You make me feel. I feel so young. All right. I got you in my grasp now, I can tell. That's cool. All right, did anybody see any old people in those pictures? No. See, when I'm around older folks, I feel young. And not because I'm chronologically younger, though I'm catching up. I am catching up. But because of their youth and vitality, right? And their spirit. And that's the people I'm going to talk about today to make some points about life that we already know, but need some reinforcing every once in a while. So you heard a little bit of my background, all that healthcare seriousness stuff. But I've also been, before I was anything else in life, I was a musician. At 13, I was playing underage in clubs in Philadelphia. So music is part of an integral part of my life. And in fact, I started out in hospitals, was gigging in nightclubs, casinos in Atlantic City, that kind of stuff. Got out of that because I was tired of all the bands, because it was like having another family and all the politics of bands, and I said, forget it. And then a guy who worked for me in the hospital was also a professional juggler on the side, and he said, you should go check out some of these senior communities. So in 1992, I walked into a CCRC in Atco, New Jersey. Then it was called Harvest Village, and I started singing for seniors. And that was like 3,000 performances ago. And it changed the trajectory of my healthcare career and my singing career. Went up to New York, helped launch a company up there that worked with seniors, and then we moved down to Charlotte. So anyway, I am from Philly. My name is Anthony. But in Philly, they don't call you Anthony. What do they call you?
Tony.
Yeah, Tony. I mean, or they say Antony. Antony. So I will not be offended. I am Italian, 100%. If what I'm going to do is I'm going to count to three. I want you to do the Italian hand signals, and I'm not going to be offended. And at the end of three, I just want you to say, yo, eh, all right? Get your hands going. Come on. It's like rolling dice. It's craps. Ready? One, two, three.
Yo, eh.
More enthusiasm. One, two, three.
Yo, eh.
That's better. There we go. All right. So I know most of you work in the business, but this presentation is not about the business. If you want domain expertise, you should have saw me Monday. I spoke at the Argentum Healthcare Senior Executive Conference in New Orleans, and I spoke about your brain on music. So if you wanted real information there, no. This is about why, remembering why we are in the business, right? And who we serve. And I know there's probably some caregivers, even if you're in a professional role, you might be a caregiver as well. We know that caregivers need to take better care of themselves, and I'm hoping some of these points help with that. We know that many caregivers have worsened health than the ones they're taking care of, and some of them predecease the one they're taking care of. And I should know. So that's my mom. She has since passed. Philomena, how is that for an Italian name? And she passed in 16, but before that, my sister was her caregiver, and my sister predeceased her in 14. So we know how important it is to take care of yourself. You know, a lot of times, physicians never ask how the caregiver is doing, right? And very seldom ask for the caregiver's input into taking care of mom or dad. I had a great physician back in Charlotte that saw the emotional toll it was taking on me when I was taking care of my mom, because after she died, we took her to Charlotte for 2.5 years. And it was joyful, and it was purposeful, and it was also crazy because my mom had all her faculties about her, and Italian moms are stubborn women. Let me just tell you about that. So this is about 8 simple lessons in life. You already have the cheat sheet in front of you with the bookmark, so I'm hoping that you will refer to that when you're reading a book at night and say, hey, did I follow some of these principles? But we all know them. So it's what we can learn today and what we can share with others. Yale says if we have positive perceptions of aging, we can add 8 years to our lives. So I'm going to start with our first. I'm not sure what I point to get that to go. Oh, there you go. So moving on to the first point. This is Ruth Ann Whitley. She was a resident of a skilled nursing facility in Charlotte, North Carolina. And I went and interviewed her for my book. My book is called Who Moved My Dentures? Whole story around that. But I was going to interview her for a specific reason, because I heard how active she was in her own community. She went in there with her mom, and her mom was sick as well, but Ruth Ann would scurry around and deliver newspapers and serve coffee. And then when her mother passed and she got a little more disabled and couldn't do as much, she took the most unenviable role in an organization, which was head of the residence council Who wants to be that? Right? You got the residents and coming at you on one side, complaining in this ear. You got administration on the other side saying why we can or can do this or that. So God bless her for doing that. So we're outside in the courtyard, and it was her office, because that's where she went and smoked. And, come on, my mother was smoking in 94. It didn't seem to happen, and she didn't buy of anything that was smoke-related, but thankfully I don't smoke. But anyway, we're out in her courtyard, she's having cigarettes, and she's telling me all about her life. And then she says, now keep in mind all the things I just told you she does. She says, I pray to God every day, and this is a woman in her 80s probably, for what my purpose in life is. So how is that for you? A woman who is in her 80s still wanting to grow and develop and have purpose. So I'm going to briefly tell you about how I found my purpose. Why I never went back to the hospital side of healthcare. This is Esther. So when I moved down to North Carolina from Philly, I started a consulting company, but you know, it was slow in the beginning, so I still had time to go sing. So I went up to Hickory, North Carolina, and there was assisted living community there, and I would sing. And you know, every month in my programs, it's you know, sometimes I'm doing the Frank Sinatra stuff, or if there's a certain thing to commemorate, I will commemorate it, whether it's 4th of July, and we'll do patriotic songs or whatever. But we know, I have a book at home that's about 6 inches thick, full of commemorative days. You know, you could celebrate National Tablecloth Day. I'm sure there's a day for it, right? So there's days for everything. So in November, I would sing Pennies from Heaven, and Esther would look at me and roll her eyes and say, what's that about? Come on. I said, come on, Esther, you don't know that it's National Accountants Month? Ba-dum-ba. I know, poor joke, but that's all right, because she would roll her eyes, and she had none of it, and then we became fast friends, and over several years. So one day I went to go and sing for the folks, and the activity director said, after you're done, I want you to go to the hospital with me and see Esther. She specifically is asking for you. I said, okay, don't know what this is about, guess we'll find out. So on the way over, she said, oh, by the way, Esther had died. She was revived, and she's in the coronary care unit, and she wants you. Again, now I'm getting a little more nervous because now I really don't know what she wants. So I get there. Her daughter's there. Esther starts flirting with me, much to the embarrassment of her daughter. Esther wants me there for one thing. She wants me to sing a song, and she wants me to sing one particular song, Because He Lives. Anybody know it? Because He lives, I can face tomorrow. One problem, where was I from? Philly. You know, I was not from the Bible Belt, right? I said, Esther, you have 100 other singers out here that can do this song. I don't know it. I said, I'm from Philly. I said, when we come down the steps of our house in the morning in Philadelphia, we have a picture of the Lord on one wall, and we have a picture of Frank Sinatra on the other one. And we bow to Frank every morning. Because it's the proper thing to do, of course. So Esther and I went back and forth and back and forth. And then I sang Unforgettable, because that's what she was. And I said, Esther, I'm going to learn that song for you. And I went home and I had a little recording studio and I learned it. I put it on the CD when they had CDs. Anybody still have CDs? And I sent it back to the assisted living community. She was back there, thankfully, but not for long. So about a week later, the activity director called me and said, Esther's in hospice. And then Esther passed. Now, I don't make it a habit to go to the funerals of every older person I've sung for, because I'd probably be quite busy. But I went to Esther's funeral. Something was telling me I needed to go to Esther's funeral. So I go, look at the program book. What's the song on the program book? Because He Lives. And then the daughter comes up to me, and the daughter told me, and others told me separately, independently, she had not cried till I walked in the room. And she came over and she hugged me. And she said, did you hear about my mom's last day of life? I said, no, I did not. She goes, on her last day of life, we played your CD with that one song over and over and over again until finally, the daughter knelt down, starts singing with me on my CD to her mom, and her mom passed that day. amazing, right? I've had a lot of those amazing musical moments where you touch people. Music's an amazing therapeutic. But for me, it was life transforming. And I still keep in touch with the daughter and the granddaughter to this day. In fact, they are dying to come hear me tell this story to people because we were all moved by it. And so Esther solidified my purpose in working in the aging space. Believe me, I would have made a lot more money if I stayed in the hospital side. But I didn't, and I couldn't, and I won't. And so everything's been in service to older folks because of the great difference we make in their lives. So purpose is our first point. So every point, the structure of this program, every point has a story, it has a snippet of a song, and then I'll tell you some scientific studies that actually back up why having purpose can actually lead to a longer life. So this particular song is beautiful. Leanne Womack. It's called I Hope You Dance. We're not going to do the whole song. But what I want you to do is I want you to maybe close your eyes during the song and think about your own purpose. Because here's the thing. When I was a family caregiver, I knew it wasn't going to last forever. And it was like, okay, so what happens when there's a void there? Ruth Ann was always questioning her purpose. People in this room might be questioning their purpose or be solidified in their purpose and maybe can help others. So think about that as we do this. All right, you can lower that a little bit. There you go. It's great to have a sound guy. I hope you never lose your sense of wonder. You need your fill to eat, but always keep that hunger. May you never take one single breath for granted. God forbid love ever leaves you empty-handed. I hope you still feel small when you stand beside the ocean. Whenever one door closes, I hope one opens. Promise me that you'll give faith a fighting chance. You get the choice to sit it out or dance.
I hope you dance.
I hope you dance. I hope you dance. All right. I hope you dance. It's great to have backup singers that are all you. In case you don't want to hit a note or can't at a certain time, you just let the backup singers do it. So having a sense of purpose in life can slash your risk of developing dementia. Evidence from 8 studies. I'm reading from my notes here because I would never be able to memorize all these studies. Evidence from 8 studies show a 19% reduced rate of clinically significant cognitive impairment. Journal American Medical Association, stronger purpose is associated with decreased mortality. Rush University, people who view life with a sense of purpose are 2 to 4 times less likely to develop Alzheimer's. So as I said, it's never too old to evolve and think about what your purpose is. Another study said purpose actually gives you discipline. And another study said that self-disciplined people are hardly organized people and have purpose usually and are less susceptible. All right. So that is point number one. It only took 20 minutes to make. I make the other ones a lot quicker. Now, how many of you ever heard of blue zones? All right. Blue zones. There you go. A few of you. Blue zones are pockets of geography around the world where people live to an amazing old age. Sort of like this woman here, Maria. I love her quote on life. Order, tranquility, good connection with family and friends, contact with nature, emotional stability, no worries, no regrets, lots of positivity, and stay away from toxic people. Amen to that one. So, in these blue zones, they have certain characteristics of their society, of how they are active, all kinds of different things. And, you know, what they practice is moving naturally. So for you and I, we may think we have to get up in the morning, hop on the treadmill, take a run. All they do is they build movement into their day. They are always moving. They don't have to do the other stuff. Of course, they're eating healthy and socially connected. We'll talk about that one in a little bit as well. I always joked that my mother-in-law, who's passed, Dolores, would come visit us in North Carolina, and if she had to use the bathroom, instead of using the powder room at the lower floor, she would climb the steps every time and go to the far reaches of the house in order to do her business there. Why? Because she wanted to move naturally. She was always moving, and she was in amazing shape. You know, I when I first started going in the care homes, as they call them in the UK, and started singing for folks, you know, I made a revelation, not a big one, but, you know, a lot of times I believe that age didn't catch up with people. It's that just people did not keep up with themselves. And so I believe that when you're talking about aging, we all need to prepare when we're young, physically, financially, emotionally. The World Health Organization, unfortunately, says that we are one of the most obese nations in the world. If you're slightly overweight in your 50s, this is a disturbing fact. You have a 20 to 40% chance of dying in the next decade. All right, so we're not going to have that happen now because we're going to get some exercise. Are you ready for some exercise? Now, if we're going to get some exercise, we might go to the gym, right? Now, if you want to go to a free public gym, where might we be going? No, not yet. Yes, louder. The Y, as in four letters. Y, yes. YMCA. So we're all going to the YMCA for about a minute and a half. So everybody get up. Come on. I'm watching you. It gets worse after the next song. I'm going to see some weird letters being made, I can tell. You see the whole alphabet made during this. Young man, there's no need to feel down. I said, young man, pick yourself off the ground. I said, young man, cause you're in a new town. There's no need to be unhappy, young man. There's a place you can go. I said, young man, when you're short on your dough, you can stay there. And I'm sure you will find many ways to have a good time. All right, it's your turn. It's fun to stay at the
YMCA.
It's fun to stay at the
YMCA.
YZQ4, what? You can have a good meal. You can do whatever you feel. They have everything for your men to enjoy, and women too. Hang out with all the boys. Come on.
YMCA. YMCA.
I'll get those hands clapping in the middle, in between.
YMCA.
Oh, now they're singing. Uh-oh.
YMCA.
Whoa. There you go. Good job. All right. If you take 2 20-minute walks a day, you can make your real age appear 5 years younger. Yet overweight people who do not get exercise actually can age minus 8 years. So we don't want that. We all know the benefits of exercise to cognitive health and mental health. There's been, enough studies out there that show that it can reduce the possibility of, or at least ward off, or hold it off, dementia and Alzheimer's. In fact, seniors who get little or no exercise have a 50% greater risk of developing dementia. So we want to get our exercise. So here's the thing. I want to thank you for enthusiastically participating and clapping, because it's good for you. It's releasing all kind of great energy, and it's also good for me, because you see, I'm male and I'm an Italian. And what do they say we have? We have big what? Wait a minute, where are you going with that? No. No, we have big egos. Robin, you didn't tell me about this. So we need to laugh, right? Yeah, we take ourselves too seriously sometimes. And so I really should get that disgusting picture off there for now. All right, there you go. They told me I couldn't dim slides, so usually I dim it right there. But, I'll get to my point in a minute, but my male ego, my wife says to people that I never met a mirror I didn't like. Right? Because, I get up in the morning, and I had a little more hair then, and I would get all ready. Maybe even this morning I might have thought it to myself. I didn't say it out loud. But, I would go up. And this was more for her benefit. And what did I say, ladies? I said, it doesn't get much better than this. So you think I'm kidding, but this is kind of funny. Leave it to the Brits. The Brits had a survey that found the average man looks at himself in the mirror 23 times a day, compared to 16 for a woman. So I was telling this story before I knew that study. They say the men look in the mirror to admire their appearance. And the women look to make sure they look okay. So humor is our next point. When I started singing in communities, I quickly realized that there were different communities I liked to sing at and others I didn't. I'm from Philly. The Philadelphia Flyers hockey team has a mascot. It's called Gritty. Rocky Balboa, he's from New York originally, but he picked Philly because we're gritty. We're blue collar. We like to have fun. I like rowdy crowds. But a lot of times, evidently, I go into some communities and I call them the polite golf clapping crowd. I shouldn't say that. It's like sacrilegious in a golf club. But you give it all. You give it all and you have a, there's 2 inches of sweat on the ground, and then they go like this. Very good. I don't want that. So we need to bring more humor in our life, and we are right now, because I think I've had CEOs from major companies play along with this little thing here. But let me tell you a little about humor before we do it, and there's some bribes involved. Loma Linda University said that all those endorphins and all those great chemicals that your body produces when you're exercising, they produce the same chemicals when you are laughing, right? So 54,000 Norwegians were surveyed about humor in their lives. 2,000 had cancer. The ones who had cancer who had the most humor, 35% less likely to die. So we need more humor in our lives. You ever hear of laughter yoga? Yeah. Laughter yoga is this very contrived thing that then becomes hysterical. People start out laughing for no reason at all, and then you can't stop yourself from laughing. So I'm hoping we have a little bit of that. So here's what we're going to do. In the springtime when I sing in places, and I talk about the birds coming back north from wherever they're at, and I say we sing about a bird. So anybody want to guess what bird we might pick? No, there's no Oriole songs out there. If I had an Oriole song, not a blue jay. Yes, the robin. But not the red, red robin that goes bob, bob, bobbing along, because that's too lame. No, we're going to do the rockin' robin. Or I should say you're going to do the rockin' robin. So what do birds do? They all tweet. Right, now remember, this is the humor part of the program. So I want you all to tweet. Come on, tweet. A little more enthusiasm. Tweet, tweet. All right, now, what else do birds do? They flap their wings. This is sort of like a chicken dance. So flap, get up now. Come on, I want you to flap your wings and start tweeting. Ready, come on. Look at this guy right here. I looked at him when they came in and I said, this is the most unassuming guy. I would never expect him to be having fun over here. Look at him. All right, you're warmed up. I get it. Hey, Robin, now I need you and somebody else, two people. So I have my book here and I have my CD here. And we're going to award the best tweeter flappers of this segment. And you could choose either the CD or the book, which, by the way, I have more at my table back there. So if you're ready, you can walk around. You can see who's enthusiastic. You know, don't throw things at the judge if you weren't picked by, yeah. All right, you ready? I'll tell you when the tweet and flap, but you could, you know, clap and go crazy at will. There we go. Oh, look, you're already at it. He rocks in the treetop all night long, hopping and a bopping and a singing his song. All the little birdies on Jaybird Street, they want something. Tweet, 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 rockin' Robin. Rockin' Robin. Go rockin' Robin, cause we're really gonna rock tonight. Every little swallow, every chickadee, every little birdie on the old oak tree. Wise old owl, here we go, the big black crow, flapping them wings, saying, go bird, go, Rocky Robin. Rocky Robin, I'm getting out of the way now. Go Rocky Robin, cause we're really gonna rock tonight. Heard a little raven at the bird's first dance, taught him how to do the bop and it was grand. Started going steady and bless my soul. Out popped somebody here. And a bopping and a singing his song. All the little birdies on Jaybird Street love to hear the robin go. Rock a robin. Rock a robin. Go rock a robin, cause we're really gonna rock tonight. We're not done yet. Little raven at the bird's first dance, taught her how to do the bop and it was grand. Started going steady and bless my soul. I popped the buzzard and the Oreo. He rocks in the treetop all night long, hopping, bopping, bopping along. Love to hear the robin go. Rock a robin. Rock a robin. Go rock a robin, cause we're really gonna rock tonight. All right, it's the end of the song. Tweet and flap at will. Come on. Tweet it. Tweet it. All right, good job. All right, Robin. Of course. Hey, person over here. What is your name? Gail. Would you like a CD or a book? You would like a CD. There you go. All the songs from this program right there on that one. All right. We got a second? I don't know. Pauline? Come on up, Pauline. Would you like a CD or a book? A book. Yeah, I would imagine CDs are not your thing. All right. Ah, my goodness gracious, that was fun. Where's my clicker? All right. Did anybody ever hear of a group called the Raging Grannies? A couple of you, very good. The Raging Grannies, the ones I interviewed in my book, were based in Seattle, but their original group is based in Canada. And they're essentially a older folk, women protest group, right? The group in Seattle would go out and protest nuclear submarines off the coast of Seattle. Some of them even got arrested, right? So they're very proud of their activism. And so what I love about them is that they have people who are in assisted living and skilled nursing who help them. Their thing is, as you can see, they have crazy costumes. So the residents will help them if they can't actually go out and protest. They will help with parody songs, and they'll go out and be singing these crazy songs. And what this all brings up for me is another point, and it's called lifelong learning. It's the next point on your official bookmark if you're keeping tally. Lifelong learning. You know, we lose evidently 5,000 brain cells a day. There they went. So people who remain intellectually involved can reduce their real age by 2.5 years. A famous coach and speaker, Jim Rohn, says, formal education gets you a job, self-education gets you rich, right? Now, doesn't mean formal education isn't a bad thing. I've had enough of it, certainly. But consider some of these folks. Brian Lowe, at 102, got a master's from Cambridge University in 2016. Nola Ox, a lot of people know about her. She's passed since, but oldest college graduate at 95. She lived to 105. After graduation, Princess Cruises hired her as a guest lecturer. So, another woman, Lorna Prendergast, she was seeing how much dementia affected people in Australia. So she took a Master's of Aging course and got a degree at the University of Melbourne in July at the age of 90. So there you go. So in order to be able to have a lifelong learning, what do we need? We need a what? A brain. That's right. Let me see if the, what, trying to hear the music here. There we go. I could while away the hours conferring with the flowers, consulting with the rain. But my head I'd be scratching while my thoughts were busy hatching if I'd unravel every riddle for any individual in trouble or in pain. With the thoughts you'd be thinking, I could be another Lincoln if I... That's right. Oh, I could tell you why the ocean's near the shore. I could think of things I've never thunk before, and then I'd sit and think some more. I would not be just a nothing, my head all full of stuff in my heart all full of pain. I would dance and be merry, life would be a ding-a-derry if I... Boom, 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 boom. All right. So thank you. Spontaneous applause at any time is good. Because remember, I'm Italian and male, and we have big egos. That's right. All right. You know, the one thing I've learned is, you know, so I worked in regular jobs until I went down to the Carolinas, and I've sort of been an entrepreneur a little bit. But the thing, you know, I've realized with entrepreneurs, and I don't know if anybody's ever read the Napoleon Hill's book, Think and Grow Rich, right? What he did was go around... back in the day and interviewed the Rockefellers and the Vanderbilts and asked them all about what was their success and secret, you know, secrets to life. And a lot of it was just being curious, you know, and asking why. And I think from a lifelong learning standpoint, if we just do what babies and young kids do all the time, but why, but why, but why, I think we'd learn a whole heck of a lot more. All right. Now, this is Carolyn and Betty. They were fast friends at an assisted living community in Spartanburg, South Carolina, or as they called it, middle school with wrinkles. And so they were not friends until they met in this community. And so I went and interviewed them for my book because that part was all about socialization and friendships. And Betty still had her home and still had her car, and yet she chose to live in the assisted living. But they were safety nets in case she ever left. But she was not leaving because she had her best friend right there, right? So she was there for the socialization. And Carolyn, she made an important point. She said, you know what? We no longer have neighborhoods. We have streets. Think about that. So I grew up in where? South Philly, not just Philly, South Philly. And in South Philly, we hung on the stoop, right? And my best friends to this day are still my grade school buddies. I've been to more grade school reunions than high school and certainly not college. I still keep in touch with them to this day because we formed bonds on those stoops that were lifetime. So this next part about socialization and friendship, Duke and the University of Arizona say the average person reports having just two friends, and one in four people have no one to confide in. The New York Times did an article a few years ago, and it said, we no longer go to work to be efficient, not necessarily to form bonds with people. And they said that 30% have a close friend at work. Now, I imagine working in this industry, the bonds are closer. But having friends at work has actually decreased over time. And of course, when you have pandemics and social isolation and working at home, there's more so. And so I was talking to a few people about, and this was certainly a big topic at the Argentum conference, social isolation is a huge epidemic among folks. And it's actually gotten worse since the pandemic, because there's a lot of able-bodied older folks who otherwise would go out and do this or that, who, because maybe they have some chronic conditions and feel compromised, are now afraid to go out in public. They've gotten more skittish. And, you know, being by yourself is not necessarily a bad thing. I just wrote an article for 60 and Me that made the distinction between being alone versus feeling lonely. And being alone is a physical state. You know, my wife was traveling last week. When I get home tomorrow, she will still be away. I'm alone. Am I lonely? Nah, not at all. I can keep myself very occupied. So there's a distinction there. But social isolation is a huge issue. And I just actually started a senior entertainment network of live streaming so that we can address that with people. So think about that as we do this next song, Carolyn and Betty. And it's a Carol King song, of course, that was made famous by James Taylor. And I changed the words up a little bit to fit a care setting, at least for the first verse. When you're down and troubled and you need a helping hand and nothing is going right. All right, here's your change here. Flip your lights and think of me, and soon I will be there to brighten up even your darkest night. You just turn on your lights and you know that you'll be all right. I'll come running to check on you again. There's no need to risk a fall. All you have to do is call, and I'll be there, yes I will. All right, your turn to sing.
You just call out my name. You know wherever I am, I'll come running. See you again. Winter, spring, summer, or fall, all you gotta do is call, and I'll be there, yes I will. You've got a friend.
All right. Thank you, thank you. So, Now, I know when I go to conferences, a lot of times people stay at the same table, same group of people in their little clique, right? So I'm only going to give you about a minute to do this. Because believe me, I'll rein you in. Because Robin has a schedule. So I'm going to give you a minute. I want you to go find somebody you don't know in this room. Quickly introduce yourself to them. Tell them where you're from, why you're here. Make it quick. Hi. All right, you got 30 seconds to wrap it up. 29, 28, 27, 26, 5, 24, 23, 22, 21, 20, 19. All right, people, back in your seat. Back in your seat. Get back in your seat. All right, break it up, break it up, break it up, break it up. See, this is what happens. This is what happens. Everybody gets out of control. All right, I'm going to continue because I know you'll stop jibber-jabbering us in a second. All right, so the American Journal of Psychiatric Health says social support helps protect against dementia. The Journal of Pain, social support reduces pain and depression. The New York Times, maintaining social activity despite health-related challenges appears to help lessen decline in well-being. So that's kind of interesting. If you if two exact people have the same exact conditions, but one is more social than the other one has a better chance of being healthy. And of course, it's true, we're spending less time with each other because of the internet and all kinds of things like that. And as I say, you know, technology and the internet and all these things, they have good points, they have bad points. Some exacerbate loneliness, some can increase connection. But we even found with the connection from a lot of communities where they were doing the FaceTime and the things like that, it actually led to more depression because the people couldn't see their loved ones in person. So it's kind of crazy. So, but friendship, and obviously you are dying to meet other people here because I couldn't get you to sit back down. All right. Don't you love this woman with just by looking at her? Yeah. Her name's Jean Kopeck. And the very first place I went and spoke at or sang at, she was there. Now, she was a mild-mannered housewife. She was widowed quite young. Like my mom was. My dad died at 49. And so she just bore down, put her kids through college, never had another relationship, and yet she came to the skilled nursing. She probably could have stayed home and had home health, but she chose to be there. She didn't want to be a, quote, burden to her sons. But the beauty of her was she thrived once she got there. She participated in absolutely everything, right? And she would come to all my programs and just, you know, the activity director was driving her around one day in a convertible in the parking lot. And she was wearing this scarf and her hair was blowing all, you know, all that kind of stuff. She was just having a great old time because you know why? She had a great what? Attitude. That's right. And, you know, I was telling you about the Napoleon Hill thing, but besides being curious, all of these people just manifested positivity in their thoughts, which led to positivity in their action. Columbia University did a study that said people who are enthusiastic and content are less likely to develop heart disease. A Swedish study said social people who don't sweat the small stuff are 50% less likely to develop dementia. So our family went through a spat where I was both family caregiver and grieving at the same time. We had from December of 13 through January of 18, we lost five family members, including my mother, my wife's parents, her older brother, and my older sister. Those two within 3 weeks of each other. Crazy. So do you think that I sweat the small stuff anymore? No. So don't get hung up on that. Have a great attitude every day. Or as this song might say, we need to have what? High? There you go. It all fits, right? I said it all fits. Next time you're found with your feet and all your chin on the ground, there's lots to be learned. Just look around. Just what makes that little old ant think he'll move that rubber tree plant? Anyone knows an ant can't move a rubber tree plant. But what he's got, he's got
high hopes.
He's got He's got high apple pie in the sky hopes. So anytime you're getting low, instead of letting go, just remember that ant. Oops, there goes another rubber tree.
Oops, there goes another rubber tree.
Oops, there goes another rubber tree plant. High hopes. He's got
high hopes.
He's got high apple pie in the sky hopes. Let's put the hands together. All problems, just a toy balloon. They'll be bursting soon. They're just bound to go what? Pop! Oops, there goes another problem kerplop.
Oops, there goes another problem kerplop.
Oops, there goes another problem kerplop.
Kerplop.
All right. High hopes. All right. Thank you. All righty. 9 minutes and 38 seconds, my clock says. All right. The World Health Organization says that the United States is the most depressed nation in the world. Depression, mental health, 9.6%. Antidepressants are our most commonly prescribed drug, right? Here's an interesting thing. In launching my little entertainment thing, I've been doing a lot of work with Music for Dementia in the UK and learning a lot about the UK health system. In the UK health system, they have something called social prescribing. Social prescribing. They actually, it's administered through general practitioners, and they have workers in their office who then make it happen. What do I mean by that? So you go into a doctor here in the U.S., and you say, I'm having some anxiety. Here, take this pill. You go in the office in the U.K., and they said, I'm going to prescribe an arts program for you. I want you to go take a walk in nature. Here's a music program for you. Social prescribing. Perhaps we need more of that in what we do. So our depression rate, 9.6%. Nigeria's rate, 0.8%. Because they say in the U.S. we engage in existentialist despair. What the heck is that? Well, you know, you might be that hotshot Wall Street lawyer who didn't quite make partner yet, and you're just whining and complaining about it because you didn't make partner yet. Well, isn't that too bad? You know what my wife says to those people? She says, suck it up, cupcake. People who practice gratitude, and of all the points I make, this is the one after thousands of performances. I see seniors with some of the worst. If I had that medical condition or whatever, and I say, they're for the grace of God, and they are grateful. They're grateful for the things that they have. So when I think of gratefulness, you know, we all have different religions. Of course, being Italian in Philly, what am I? Catholic, of course. I know we have a lot of the Jewish faith here. But whatever, I still believe there's like one supreme being, whether you believe in all the other prophets that came. And so when I sing this song, this is for that. And you all know this one. God, when I in awesome wonder consider all worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, the power throughout the universe displays. Then sings my soul, my Savior God to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou art. Almost. How great thou art. All right. Oh, a standing O, look at that. Thank you very much. Thank you. All right. We have a few more minutes, just in time. I'm going to end this right on the money. Well, you got to do this next one quick. I want you to turn to your partner at your table and tell them how grateful you are for them being in your life and being here today. Make it fast. All right. Oh, now they're hugging. All right. Perfect. I give you one excuse to talk to your neighbor, and the whole program goes down the drain. All right. Now, what I try to do every day, you know, everybody has different ways of paying it forward, right, with gratitude. Whether you're at a toll booth and you say, I'll take the pay the next one, or buy somebody something, or whatever. I like to practice three gratitudes at night, you know, reflect on my day and think about what I'm grateful for. All right, folks, now the gratitude's great enough over there. They're still grateful for everybody. They're a little too grateful. All right. So grateful people are happier, healthier. They have improved psychological, emotional, and physical well-being, et cetera, et cetera. One final story, no song, no study, but I'm going to tell you about Fanny. I don't even have a picture of her. Fanny was at that same place in Attica with that wonderful Jean Kopeck, and she would come and listen to my programs every day, and every time, I would say. And the thing is, she couldn't see me because she was blind and an amputee, and she was also African American. And the reason I bring this up, because I was born and raised in South Philadelphia, and believe me, there was a lot of racism in Philly, and unfortunately, probably even in my own family. So, you know, how ironic that after every program, I would go sit at the edge of Fanny's bed, and we would just talk. I'd literally be there another half an hour just kibitzing with Fanny. Because Fanny and I saw no color, right? We just saw unconditional love for each other. And that's the point I'll leave you with. So let's review what we have learned today, right? We've had purpose, the ability to stay active. You did some crazy letters during YMCA. You acted like birds and tweeted and flapped, and I think you actually had fun and let your hair down, which we don't do enough of. We talked about lifelong learning, friendships, having a great attitude, gratefulness, and love. And as I said, in a general sense, when I started working in the aging space, my general message was simply, people need to start preparing for aging sooner in life, from their physical standpoint, their emotional standpoint, and their financial standpoint. 57% of Americans think they are fit. Statistics would say otherwise. This is the word, the craziest. 30% of baby boomers have saved less than $10,000 for retirement, right? We've got to get people thinking about this stuff. My wife is a savior, was a saver. My wife, in her 30s, when her company offered a volunteer benefit of long-term care insurance, she bought it. She pays in 1 year what most people pay in a month because she was preparing for her aging. So, educated aging. So I'll leave you with this. I think we get one shot, unless you believe in reincarnation. Perhaps I come back as a Rockin' Robin. Who knows? But I think being from Philly, with a picture of Frank Sinatra on my wall, which I never had, by the way. But I listened to a lot of Frank. We listened to a lot. You only get one shot. And really, this is the only song that kind of makes sense for that. And thank you for having me. What a wonderful time. That's life. Oh, background singers, great. That's what people say. You're riding high in April, shot down in May. I know I'm gonna change my tune when I'm back on top in June. Get ready, background singers. That's life. Funny as it seems, some people get their kicks stomping on your dreams. I don't let it get me down, 'cause that old world keeps spinning around. I've been a puppet, pauper, pirate, poet, pawning a king, up, down, over, under. I know one thing, each time I find myself flat on my face, I pick myself up and get back in the race. That's life. Thank you, background singers. I can't deny it, I thought of quitting, but my heart just won't buy it. If I didn't think it was worth one more try, I'd roll myself up in a big ball and die. All right. Thank you, everybody. My name's Anthony Cirillo. I'm not sure if they wanted me to take questions or if there's, I don't know how you even ask a possible question after that. If I was doing something that was about marketing or customer experience, you might have a specific question. How do you do that? You might say, well, Anthony, how do you sing? No, I can't teach you that. I don't know that. So, Robin, what's next on our wonderful agenda? If anybody has a question, you could just go up to the mic and say, Anthony, you're just wonderful. You know, if you want to do that, that's a statement. But if you are inclined to do that, go up to that microphone and ask me something. So that table said, we here think you're wonderful. I'm buying that table a glass of water. I got a question that I can't believe.
Yes, sir. No to your younger self, please.
No, what's that?
What would be the no to your younger self?
Um, You know, my note to my younger self is, you know, I don't know how much I would change. I got to tell you that my father's passing when I was 11 changed my entire life. But I just didn't know it at the time. You know, when you grow up without a father, he made me take guitar lessons, and I hated it. And I put the guitar behind the door. But after he died, I picked it up. And look what I would have been if I never picked it up, if he never had me. So if it was a note to younger self, it would be, you know, for me, was to get involved. You know, be true to yourself. Because, you know, I've been blessed with it. My wife has followed a corporate career. And she's had the meteoric rise. You know, we're very competitive, whether it's pickleball or cards or tennis or whatever it might be. And in our careers, up until we left Philadelphia, we were neck and neck. Our levels of position in the organization, our salaries and all that kind of time. And then we went to the Carolinas, and she worked for Ingersoll Rand, and she was a corporate director of global human resources. She traveled the world. Her career went, and mine went like, okay, good days, bad year, bad year. But because of her, I was able to be true to what I'm doing here. I would have never done any of this. I would have never had adventures. I've spoken in Dubai. I've gone to Saudi Arabia to consult. None of that would have been possible if we didn't move from a high cost of living in New York to Charlotte, and her meteoric career allowed me to be true to myself. Now, that's easier said than done if you don't have that support in back of you. But nonetheless, we all hear the stories of people who slept in their cars and didn't do that, but when they came back through and they finally broke through, we love them for it. So anyway, I don't know if that's my message to myself, but it was a defining moment in my life. I probably never actually told that publicly, but how much it defines my life, but it's absolutely true.
You are marvelous. Bill and Shannon Miller opened up 2 weeks ago the grand opening of the Frank Sinatra Lounge in Nashville.
Oh, cool.
They also own the Johnny Cash Museum, and I'm going to give you my card because I think it's something that you'd like to have a tour.
All right.
All the restaurants that they own and also meet them.
I could probably buy a picture of Frank and now hang it, right?
Yes.
Well, thank you. I'll be at a table out back, and I have some of my CDs and books if anybody's interested in them. So I think we're good now. I think I hand it back to you. Is that how it works? Well, thanks, everybody.
Oh, my goodness. That was amazing, Anthony. Thank you so much. We all enjoyed it. We got our steps in, 1,926. Thank you very much. That helps reach my 10,000 goal for today. We appreciate your insightful and informative presentation, which sets the stage for the rest of our magnificent day. Shortly, we will have a break until 10:30, and then at 10:30, you can proceed to one of the first two breakout sessions. So I'm going to outline them here for you, but you have your program, and they're also out there. It's a lot of information, even for the younger people, but there's our team is at the desks. Just stop by, ask questions if you're lost. Our first two breakout sessions are breakout session number one, the joys and struggles of growing older. How do men and women differ? Presented by Dr. Deborah Carr, professor of sociology and director of the Center for Innovation and Social Sciences at Boston University. This breakout will be held in the special events room and also be live streamed for our virtual audience. And then breakout session number two, is good sleep a key to healthy aging? Will be presented by Dr. Adam Spira, who's a professor and vice chair for research and faculty at the Department of Mental Health at Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. This session will be held in the pre-function space near the registration out here. You will see our team when you leave the room, and they'll help direct you. Each breakout session will last for 1 hour. We will then have a short break, and then you have the opportunity to attend one of two different breakout sessions, which are the second group of breakout sessions, and those begin at 11:45. The first one of the second group is Optimizing Aging. Focus on physical activity opportunities rather than loss and decline, to capitalize on what Anthony taught us this morning. and that'll be presented by our own Dr. Carolyn Green Eichberg, licensed clinical psychologist. And this will be held in the special events room and also be live streamed for the virtual audience. And in that session, there's a breakout session number 2, which is titled LGBTQ Older Adults, Respected and Whole, will be presented by Alex Kent of Sage Care. This breakout session will be held in the pre-function space right out here. Then at 12:45, all of those sessions end and will conclude, and we'll reconvene here in this room for lunch, and we'll enjoy our keynote speaker, our very own Arelis Torres, who's our clinical nutrition manager at Charles E. Smith Life Communities, and she'll speak about nutrition and longevity. Some information on continuing education credits for those of you who need credits. Those will be available for nurses, social workers, and nursing home administrators. Make sure you sign in at the desk located near the registration. You'll need to complete the survey at the end of our program, and once you complete the survey, you will receive your certificate. For those attending virtually, you will receive the survey via email on Friday. That's tomorrow. If you have questions, please stop by the registration desk, and we hope you enjoy the rest of your day. Thank you.